Hello, my name is Hugo Marques de Sousa, and this is Connected, the podcast of Nova Economics Club.
Today's guest is Nuno Crato, former Minister of Education and Professor of Econometrics at ISEG. He took part in Economia Viva, our cycle of debates, where he discussed with Maria Emília Santos, Carlos Oliveira, and Anabel Conreis the topic Teaching in the Digital Age. If you want to listen to the full debate, just check the YouTube page of Economia Viva. Don't forget also to follow Nova Economics Club on Instagram, Facebook, LinkedIn, and to subscribe our YouTube channel. On this episode, we will continue the discussion of this topic with Nuno Crato. Digitalization of education is a powerful trend in terms of reformation and modernization of global education environment. Digitalization means transformation of all information types, texts, sounds, visuals, video, and other data from various sources into the digital language. When discussing the phenomenon of digitalization, it should be noted that various analysts and forecast experts consider the transition of education process into digital stage as the turning point in the history of education. EU 2020 Education Development Strategy, adopted in 2014, focuses on digital technologies. This document appeared to mirror impressive achievements in IT area, with its core objective being the integration of state-of-the-art IT solutions in education institutions' activities across EU. What is the balance that you do about this digitalization development of the teaching system? What do you consider to be the main consequences of these transformations? And how do you think this is different for the different levels of education?
Well, thank you very much again for your invitation. It's a pleasure to be here with you. It's a complex question, the question you just raised. It's a complex question. Let me say, try to go in parts. Well, first, I think that the first conclusion that we can draw from this experience that we had is that nothing replaces face-to-face learning. That means that idea, and I repeat this all the time, that idea that sometimes people had about 5, 10, 20, 30 years ago, the idea that computers will replace classrooms, that people will stay at home, that people will study the way they want, that teaching would be individualized, that it would be much better to use computers than to use a classroom, that idea has proven to be wrong. And I have to insist with this because in education, there are many times many ideas that seem to be very revolutionary, very interesting, and actually they don't work. And so I have always to insist with this because people, many for a long time, had had defended these type of solutions that really don't work that well. That's the first thing. But this is an old story because, as you know, people from a long time ago have said the same things. Even Thomas Edison, for instance, in 1913 or something about that, said that, oh, teachers and books, all this will be obsolete in a few years. Everything will be taught by the movies, through the movies. And we know it's not true. So more than one century has passed since Thomas Edison said that that prophecy, that false prophecy, and it didn't happen. So, and from time to time, people have these strange ideas. In 79 or about that, in 1980, about that, Lyotard, who is a French philosopher, the French postmodernist philosopher, said the same thing, that that computers will replace teachers. Teachers will be used only to teach students how to use computers. Now we know it's exactly the contrary, is that teachers are necessary and not really to teach students how to use computers, because many times students are much more proficient with computers than teachers. So that's not true. Okay, but having said that, my main conclusion is that nothing replaces the face-to-face learning. We have to say that we were surprisingly good at switching from face-to-face learning to online learning. We were surprisingly good. And I'm talking about Portugal, I'm talking about most of the European and North American and Australia, most of the countries, except for a couple of countries that didn't have the possibility to do it. And in Portugal, if you look about it, it was so smooth. I'd say that one day or 2 days or 1 week after the school closure, we were immediately adapting to the new system, and teachers in high schools and all across the country at universities and so on were moving towards digital platforms. And we did the best we could. And when I'm saying we did, I'm saying the students, the teachers, the professors, everybody did the best we could, and we did reasonably well. So that I'd say that's my second conclusion. Now, your question, I don't remember exactly the whole question, but I think I answered the first part of your question.
For the different levels of education, what do you think?
Oh, different levels of education. That's true.
What do you think that for example, for the younger ones, they are more affected than the older ones? For example, university or the kindergartens or something?
Well, I think it's obvious that for students that are at the college level, or even students that are at the high school level, things are easier, because students at this level have better control over themselves, over their schedule. They know that they have to be autonomous in a couple of things, and so they pay more attention to the classes, they organize their schedule, they organize their study better than students that are at the elementary school level or middle school level even. So I'd say that this worked much better for universities than for elementary schooling, and everything in between worked with this type of transition. That's natural. That's absolutely natural. One of the main difficulties in online learning is that we don't interact the same way we interact when we are in a classroom. When we are in a classroom, let's talk about, for instance, let's imagine elementary schooling. We are in a classroom. We have a teacher. The teacher is trying to connect to the students all the time. Just glancing with the eyes through the classroom knows who is paying attention, who is not paying attention, who is struggling with something, who is pretending to do the work and is not doing the work. And this type of glance around the classroom and the kind of interaction that immediately is able to, it's possible to establish, like, oh, John, oh, João, oh, Hugo, pay attention. What's your answer to this? All this type of connection is much, much, much easier in a classroom setting than online. Yeah, well, we know, I try to do the same online, and I know it's very difficult, because I go and say, oh, Rachel, are you paying attention? And then Rachel wakes up and turns on her mic and says, oh, yes, professor. So it's much more difficult, because people, when I'm teaching an online classroom, even at graduate level that I'm teaching now, it's very difficult to understand what's going on in people's minds, even if they all have the camera on. And this interaction is very important, because the professor or the teacher needs to be at all times understanding what's going on students' minds. And even if in a big lecture, What a good teacher does, even in a big lecture hall, is that a good teacher looks at one face here, one face there, and with this type of interaction and this type of a glance, the teacher or the professor knows what's going on in a few of the minds of the students. And that's important. That's kind of represents the whole classroom. So I'd say that all this type of interaction is much more difficult to do online and much more difficult for younger with the younger students than with more mature students.
Mm-hmm. Even though, for example, remote work became a reality during this pandemic, and there are companies like Liberty Seguros, for example, that have already decided to remain fully remotely, even after the pandemic is over. All of this has raised the debate on remote education as well. And despite, as you said, this not seeming plausible at all for younger children and for education at all, do you believe that fully remote high schools or university are set to exist soon? That there are going to be some schools that are going to think about it? Or?
Well, this is like McDonald's. I hate McDonald's food. I'm sorry to say that. I don't know if you like it or not, but I don't like McDonald's food. But I'm very happy McDonald's exists. So let's say, as a student, I wouldn't like to be in a remote classroom, but it's good that they exist. And for some students, sometimes, some parts of their life, it's very good to have this type of alternative. And so I'd say that we have experimented with remote teaching for a while. I'm talking about pre-pandemic times. We have experimented, and some experiences were better than others, but it was an experience here, an experience there. The idea about the open university is an old idea, and essentially after World War II, a couple of open universities, that means remote universities, were set, and people would take courses by correspondence, so they'd receive something by mail, then they would do some reading, they would question, send by mail their questions, and so on. And this has worked, and it has fulfilled a need, and the needs for some people who cannot attend classes, who have to study by their own because they need to work at the same time, or they are at a remote place and so on. That type of open university, even with by mail, was good. Of course, by mail is not as good as being in the classroom. Now, we improved a lot because, look, the type of remote classroom we are talking about now is much, much, much better. No discussion about it than the study by email. So it's much better. But even so, it's not ideal. So I'd say that in the future, we'll have more remote learning. We'll have more access to that, and that's good, that's very good, because that's what comes from this experience. But I'd say that most students and most universities will mostly use the in-class lecture or learning or work. That's my, but well, you know what, I think it was Mark Twain who said, to forecast it's very difficult, especially the future. So
exactly,
a joke, yes. Typical Mark Twain. So it's very difficult to make predictions about what is going to happen. Although I think it's safe to say that now we have, we master better these tools. And now this will give more opportunities, and we'll use it complementarily.
In 1913, Thomas Edison predicted that books would be obsolete in the public schools of the future. Also, in 1979, Jean-François Lyotard said that didactics could be entrusted to machines and not to teachers. However, in Economia Viva, Nuncrat brought a study that showed through a metadata analysis that paper-based reading yields better comprehension outcomes than digital-based reading. It included a meta-analysis of research published between 2000 and 2017, involving more than 170,000 students from elementary to postgraduate higher education. Moreover, it also concluded that the text genre and time frame reduce the difference between both types of reading. Furthermore, the advantage of paper-based comprehension has increased over the years since 2000.
Does this destroy the dream of some with an educational system totally based on technology and without paper? What will be really the future role of technology in the learning process? Is this is a complement, as you were saying? What can be that complement?
That's a great question, and I have to say exactly, well, to start with, I have to say that to predict it's very difficult, especially in the future. So I really don't know. But there are a few things that are known. And this thing about the reading on paper versus reading online is very interesting. I'm a very, very technological person. Look, I have a watch, an electronic watch, I have a phone, I read Kindle. I think I'm one of the first persons in maybe in the world to read books in Kindle, because the moment Kindle was released by Amazon, I bought it immediately. So I still have the first Kindle, which is nowadays standards, it's like a monster, heavy thing. So, and I immediately start reading Kindle. So don't take me wrong. I'm not saying that technology is not good, but a few studies have shown that for some purposes, the reading on paper is much better than read on Kindle. And if you are talking about novels, you want to read a novel, well, the studies show, or most studies show, that it doesn't matter. You can read a novel on paper, you can read a novel on Kindle, it's fine. You get more or less the same of the novel. I even now do something that is, I advise everybody to do, because it's a fantastic tool, is to use audiobooks. Audiobooks are fantastic, especially if you are listening to a novel at a language you don't master that well. And no one masters second language, so this thing, even for bilingual people, the pure bilingual that are absolutely balanced, that master Portuguese and English, suppose, equally well, that doesn't exist. We always master better one language than the other, or some parts of the language than the other. So, and it's a fantastic tool to listen. And nowadays, I listen much more, and I read, in terms of listen to novels, much more than 10 years ago. It's unbelievable, because I go to the gym, I'm driving, I'm walking, I'm just jogging, whatever I'm doing, I can listen to a novel. And in the original, read by a perfect person to read, like Jeremy Irons to read an English novel, or Caro Figlio to read an Italian novel, whatever. It's a fantastic tool. But of course, we have to adapt to it. I don't dare reading a book, a textbook on time series or on stochastic processes or on econometrics, which are the things that I know better. I don't dare to listen to a book in statistics. No, that's not possible. So the difference is this, so far. As far as you want to read a novel, that's fine. You can read a novel on Kindle or on a computer or on paper. It's more or less the same. You even can hear the novel. But if you want to study something, like really attention to something, then it's much better to use a paper. Now, the study that I'm talking about is a study that is online on Iniciativa Educação. Iniciativa Educação is a project that has a couple of goals: the reading for young kids, the vocational training for kids that are on their adolescence, and providing information about scientific studies that have importance that matter to education. And this is one of the studies that we put on our website. And this study is essentially shows what you said, that to read for study, for something that where you want to concentrate on paper is much better than on screen. So that's another blow to the idea that everything is going to be online. And you know, if you want to study a paper, I don't do that. So I don't do that. If I want to study a paper, I do it with my iPad and I write on my iPad. But many people younger than me prefer to study a paper by printing it and then go home and then circling and writing on the margins and so on. So paper still has lots of advantages.
Yes, in fact, to draw and to do that kind of things is one of the advantages.
May I just interrupt for one question?
Yes, yes.
For you, it's not that interesting because you are essentially graduate students and students or college level students, so it doesn't matter that much. But it's another interesting study that we discussed in Iniciativa Educação is to how to write. What's better, to write by hand or to write typing? And many studies have all gone into the same direction. And that direction is that for kids, it's much better to start writing by hand than to type. Because they have to develop this fine motricity, and because they have, and because it stays better with us when we are kids, a letter written by hand than just typed. So even for schools, the paper is still necessary. It's still very useful.
Yes, that is really interesting.
Public and mandatory education until the end of high school is a common reality nowadays in Portugal. However, this is relatively recent. Nowadays, Portugal only has 51.7% of adults with high school or more, and only half of these have a university degree. We are far away from Europe's best countries, such as Ireland, in which 47% of the population has a university degree. Furthermore, what most people do not know is that Portugal still has, nowadays, several kids who do not complete high school. We are worse than the EU average in this indicator, and worse than former Soviet countries like Estonia or Latvia. In 2020, 8.9% of Portuguese young adults had left their studies without finishing high school. This number is much higher in males, 12.6%, than in females, 5.1%.
Despite these numbers being much lower than they were, for example, 50 years ago, we still have a lot to improve on this as a country. How can the digital tools can be used in education to help change this negative paradigm? Do you think that we can use these digital tools to try to make these people more motivated, these students more motivated?
It's difficult to answer. I don't want to sound too negative. Maybe for one or two students, maybe for a couple of students, that may be important. But I'd say that the problem is not there. The problem is that many students don't start correctly their learning path. You know, and then when they arrive at a certain stage, they just give up because they didn't have the help they needed and the leadership they needed in terms of learning. And so I don't think that motivation is the key for those students, although motivation is always good, let's say to try to entice people, to tell them, though this is good, this is important for you, that's always good. So I'm not saying that motivation is not good. What I'm saying is that I don't think that's the major problem for these kids. I think the major problem is that they don't have their their knowledge based, the knowledge bases that they need to pursue their students in a more comfortable way. So I'd say that the best motivation we can give a student is to guarantee that he or she is able to cover the essential things step by step that they need to cover and to master in order to pursue their studies. And so these students, these Diana, you said that in males it was 12% or 13%, right?
Exactly.
So about that.
Yes.
About that. So these students, they gave up because they don't see their future there, or maybe sometimes they have lots of trouble, difficulties, they need to work. So I don't think that computers will be the solution for it, although it may help a couple of them, but I don't think the problem lies there. Let me make a comment to something that you said, and it's very important. By the beginning of this century, so we are in 21st century now, by the beginning of this century, for someone who was born in and lived most part of his life last century as me, I always have to recall this. So, by the beginning of the 21st century, the dropout rate for students was about 50%. So exactly. In 20 years, we improved a lot, really, essentially after 2006, essentially after that time, we improved a lot in terms of this dropout rate. So we improved a lot, really, but we still shouldn't be happy with this 9% or 13% for males that we are having now.
Yes, one of the problems that I may think for what you said was probably the familiar background is really important on this, right?
Yeah, there is a high correlation between the family background and the success of kids in school. There is a high correlation, but there is not a fatality. It's not something that exactly. is necessary, is going to happen. And we should always think about this. Of course, if you were born in a family that didn't have books at home, if you were born in a family that had lots of financial troubles, if you were born in a family that needs you to start working as soon as you can, start working, of course, your chances of success are kind of hindered by this, are kind of hurt by this. But the school has a big role here. School has a big role. And what is very clear to me, and a couple of studies have shown it, is that the way to help these kids that have that don't have this advantaged background that other kids have is to be rigorous with them at school. It's very clear. In Portugal, we have this experience. When we improved curriculum and we were more ambitious at these times, the kids, the low performing kids fraction was reduced. That means number of kids, low performing kids in school were fewer. They were fewer, the low performing kids in school, when we had a more ambitious curriculum and when we were really saying we need to be rigorous, we need to learn the basic things in math, in reading and so on, in history, all these things. Now, afterwards, when we changed and we started being less ambitious in terms of curriculum, when we started talking about when people start talking about flexibility and not being so ambitious and be more lenient towards failure, when people started having less ambition in terms of schooling, things changed and the number of low performers increased. So it's the opposite of what people sometimes think. People think, oh, we should not be that demanding to students, because if we are not that demanding, then we are helping those that have more trouble to continue their studies. No, it's the opposite. We have to be demanding with everybody, and we have to give extra help to students who are having trouble in their studies at a certain period, because that's the way to pull up everybody. And if we start saying, oh, we should water down the curriculum because a curriculum this rigorous is is not good for people with from a disadvantaged background. We are hurting people with disadvantaged background, and numbers are very clear. So if you want to study the numbers in Portugal, in other countries about this, they are very clear. More rigorous curriculum, more ambition brings everybody up. Curriculum less ambitious, less, fewer evaluation moments and so on, hurts essentially students from poorer backgrounds.
When we raise the question of digitalization of education, we sometimes forget that some students may not have the possibility of acquiring a laptop or to have access to internet at home. The predecessor of Nuno Crato in the Ministry of Education conducted a program whose objective was to democratize the use of computers in students of primary schooling through offering them all one computer. However, a study conducted in Matosinhos concluded that 89.1% of the teachers, 84.5% of the parents, and 86% of the students considered that computer Magalhães was never or rarely used in classrooms. One of the pointed reasons to these results was that teachers were not enough qualified to use those technological tools. Now, given the pandemic, all students and teachers were enforced to use them. Thus, our Prime Minister António Costa promised that a new and better program was going to be implemented in Portugal.
Do you think that these kind of programs are the way to achieve the democratization of the use of technology in schools? Is to give computers to students an enough measure? Or what can we do to guarantee that the access to technology is equal and effective to all?
I think we should do the best we can. That means, I think we should do everything at the same time. I mean, we should look at the situation. I'm against offering computers to everybody because some people already have computers. Why do they need an extra computer? That doesn't make any sense. I'm in favor of getting loans or getting help or even offering computers to students that don't have computers. That's a good thing to do, and that's essentially now. But it should have been done a few months ago, or it should have really been solved a few months ago, because now we are thinking again that in October or something like that we'll go back to school, and we are almost at the end of this school year, so it's too late. We should have done that. And I think this and access to the internet is essential because these students don't have, and a couple of other things, about this is essentially, especially for those students. So this is always the same story. When we have trouble, those that already have trouble, so in economic terms, in social terms, are those that are going to be more hurt. So we should pay special attention to this. Now, about Programa Magalhães, done in the past, that was really not successful at all. Well, let's not talk about it. It was really not successful.
But is there data about more than this study? Is there more studies about it?
I don't know about more studies all around. What I know is that people didn't really use it. You go to any school and people didn't use it. And nowadays, of course, it's completely obsolete. So nowadays, I don't think we still have it. I'd like to have one for a museum to have a Magalhães. So it was really not very helpful at the time. But that's it. We now can do much better.
Yes. Professor, thank you very much for coming. It was really a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you. I'm very grateful to you. It was a pleasure to discuss these things with you.
And for you that are listening or seeing us, stay connected.